Hello, I am Thomas Korsdalen, and I'm at sales here with Arctic Securities, especially trading and focusing on shipping shares. Today, we are very happy to welcome CEO of the largest listed LNG shipping company, Mr. Øystein Kalleklev, for an updated Flex LNG presentation. Energy security has become top priority upon the Russian invasion of Ukraine and follow-up sanctions and supply disruptions. The problems have been further underpinned by several years of underinvestment in hydrocarbons, and we face a very difficult and tight energy market. European politicians are now looking to LNG as one of the key sources of energy to replace Russian gas. This focus has led the LNG term rates to record strong levels and close to all-time high. Most recently, and the latest news in this space is just out confirming investments in gas and gas-related business will be accepted under EU's green finance taxonomy. So this should make this session extra relevant to European investors. Over the last few years, Mr. Kalleklev has diligently first built and financed a company of 13 modern vessels. Then gradually converted his fleet from more spot and index regulated contracts to basically all fixed rate coverage with long-term earnings and dividend payout visibility. With no further delay, we will now let him give us more details on how this outstanding transformation has been undertaken. Participants can pass on questions during the presentation, and we address the same at the end. So please, where did you come from? Where are you now? And how can you do better than great?
Thank you, Thomas. I'm good to be back here at Arctic. Last time I was here was 15th of April, 2021. And we were announcing our first fixed rate long-term charter with a Cheniere for four ships and eventually became five ships. And a lot of stuff have happened in the company in those 15 months. 15 months ago, we were fully open, spot exposed on all 13 ships. Today, we have long-term charters on all of them, 12 of them fixed rate, and then one on variable time charter. Last time I was here, Avance was presenting ahead of me, and they called their company the unpolished jewel of the Fredriksen system. And I replied that then Flex must be the diamond in the rough in the Fredriksen system. And we have been cutting and adjusting the diamond into a good shape the last 18 months, and I will give some update on that shortly. Let's see. Just a message from our lawyers. There are risks associated with investing in shipping stocks. I think for Flex, it's been considerably less risk now than last time I was here 15 months ago. So let's start with the recent fixtures we've done. On June 3rd, 2023, we announced three new long-term charters. We announced 2 7-year time charters for Flex Amber and Flex Enterprise. These ships have been on a variable time charter with a super major now for the last 3 to 2 years. And they are now being converted to fix higher time charter from July 1st. And these are then going all the way to the middle of 2029. We also, on the same date, announced a 10-year time charter for Flex Rainbow. She is trading with an international trading house, and she's on the second year of that time charter, and the new 10-year charter will commence in direct continuation of the existing time charter, which elapsed in January 2023, and thus this ship is covered until 2033. Altogether, this adds about $750 million of backlog to our fleet, translating into 24 years. This gives a rate of around $86,000 on average for these three fixtures. And it brings the total backlog for the company to 54 years. And we also do have an additional 28 years of optional backlog. So if we just start with, you were asking where we're coming from and where we're going. So maybe then just look back a bit back where we are coming from. If you look 5 years back, Flex LNG was a company with two LNG shipbuilding contracts. And then during the 2017 and 18, we raised around $640 million to finance the expansion of the company at a time where LNG shipbuilding prices were at all-time low. So these ships were added at a price of around $180 to $185 million at the bottom of the cycle here in 2017, 2018, early parts of 2018, and second half of 2018, the new building prices started to pick up. And they have been picking up a lot recently due to the flurry of container orders and LNG orders, increased in steel prices and raw materials, energy prices. We are now looking at $240 million for our new building. There's very few 26 slots left, so you are basically talking more 2027 delivery. So that means if you're investing $240 million per ship today, you will not have any return before 2027. And actually, the $240 million is from SSY on Friday. And when you're talking to yours these days, they are even quoting above this level. And there is TradeWinds is reporting a resale today of some new buildings above $240 million as well. So we invested in the right time. And then we have gradually started to fix these ships out, as Thomas also mentioned. We did one fixture in 2019. We felt the term rates were a bit soft at that time. So we decided to do a 5-year variable TC on this ship, where we have a floor level close to cash break even. And that was done end of 2019. And the charter took delivery of this ship in Q3 2020. And then we thought we're going to fix a lot of ships in 2020. The market balance looked very favorable, 35 million tons of new capacity around 40 ships, but COVID happened. And it wasn't really a good window to fix any ships on long-term charters. People were fixing ships on long-term charter for 10 years, even below $60,000 per day, which would destroy a lot of equity value. We rather traded all the ships in the spot market and ended up making 60,000 in TCE for 2020, despite having all the ships employed in the spot market, which was at times very challenging due to COVID. But still, it's a lot better than our cash break even of 45. And then when the market started to improve in 2021, we started to fix ships. And as I mentioned here in the introduction, we fixed 4, and then it became 5 ships to Cheniere in April. So Cheniere this year in March declared the 5th ship, Flex Volunteer. So all these ships are going on time charter to them for 3 to 3.8 years, and they can extend these ships by 2 years as well. The term market continued to tighten, and we fixed 2 more ships in May last year, Flex Constellation with delivery prompt, and then Flex Freedom, which was delivered on a five-year time charter in Q1 this year. We saw the term market tightening even further throughout 2021. We fixed 2 ships with a super major end of 2021. I'm putting in 3+2+2 years here because the structure of this TC is in a way that we expect this to be a 7-year deal rather than a 3-year deal. And then now lastly in June, we did the 3 last ships, Amber, Enterprise and Rainbow, as I mentioned, on this altogether 24 years of coverage. And then we fixed all the ships on contracts with duration more than 3 years, from 3 to 10 years each on all these ships. So that gives us the current fleet status. We were presenting our Q1 numbers in May, and we put it in our 3 open position, Rainbow, Amber and Enterprise, and put a star on them because we said, given the strength of the term market, we would expect to fix these ships on longer term charters. That was our ambition. And we also said these will probably be the best ships we have in terms of earnings. And now less than 2 months later, that is, we have turned that into a reality. And these ships then are fixed until 2029 and 2033. And you do see that we have quite a lot of coverage here. 12 ships on fixed hire, 1 ship on variable hire, none in the spot market right now, so non-applicable on the open spot. First ships for delivery or redelivery to us, this is the middle of 24. There are some options here as mentioned, so probably we will not have any ships available before 2025, maybe even possibly 2026, depending on the market. But this at least gives us a very good earnings visibility. And if when talking about earnings, if we jump to the next slide, we're given a slight revision of our guidance, given the fact that we have taken down the spot exposure. We were guiding around 80 million for second quarter. The spot market was actually better than expected in Q2, and we are revising the guiding up to close to $85 million for Q2. For Q3, we had a range of 82 to 92. As I mentioned, two of our ships on spot are now on fixed hire, so we are guiding a bit tighter with around $90 million of revenues for Q3. A bit more uncertainty about Q4, given that we have one ship on spot link contract, so we are looking at 90 to 100 million of revenues in Q4 compared to our previous estimate of 85 to 105. And altogether, this should bring us basically to the same number as last year. We were generating 343 million of revenues in 2021, and our base case is exactly the same number this year, despite the soft market at the start of the year. And this is also as a result, we have about half a year more ship year this year because we had some new buildings for delivery last year. And as you can see then, when we have repriced the whole portfolio going into Q3, we have a higher run rate revenue levels for the second half of the year going into 2023. So we do expect to be making more revenues and better TCEs next year. Last year, we had a TCE of around 75. It will be on the low 70 side this year, but we expect it to be on the high side of the 70,000 mark next year, giving better earnings per share. We have also done some financial optimization, given the fact, you know, when we financed the company, we were financing the company to have the ability to trade all 13 ships in the spot market with the risk associated with that trading strategy. Once we now have de-risked the company, we have been able to tap into cheaper debt, and we in November initiated a balance sheet optimization where we have now refinanced 6 of the 13 ships, raising 855 million of new debt financing, and thereby releasing 137 million of cash compared to an ambition of raising around 100 million. So with these new fixtures, we are aiming to also refinancing the remaining 7 ships, and we do think we can be able to raise another 100 million from this. And we have initiated this process to also then refinance these ships at better terms, both in terms of leverage, but also in terms of margins and terms and conditions. Our cash balance is still is already pretty juicy. We had a cash balance of 175 million end of Q1, and we have done these refinancings in Q2. We have one remaining in Q3, and our cash balance ended up at around $284 million for after close of Q2. So given, you know, the 175 million, the 111 million from refinancing, we are basically cash neutral in Q2, given the revenues and the fact that we have been paying out 75 cents of dividends in Q2 or during Q2, which translates into around 40 million of quarterly dividends. With the new refinancing, the pro forma cash is then getting closer to $400 million, which is, of course, a lot more money than we need to have on our hands. But we are structuring a lot of the financing as revolving credit facility, where the cost of having these credit lines are very limited. On the recent refinancing we did, we put in on $250 million revolvers, where the cost of having the credit line is 0.7% per year. So it doesn't really cost us a lot of negative carry having all this cash. And then, not surprisingly, we have been hiking up the dividend as we have been making more money and also increasing our cash position. Last 12 months, we paid out 107% of our earnings, mostly as dividend, some buybacks, during the last five quarters, the number is 101%. We have said we have certain decision factors for putting the appropriate dividend level. Q1, we were a bit weaker on the earnings and cash flow, but as I mentioned, we do expect these revenues and earnings to increase in the Q2 and Q3, and even more so in Q4. So we do expect these lights to be all green, and you can expect continued good dividend levels from us. So let's talk about the market. LNG is getting quite a lot of media attention these days. I was reading my three favorite newspapers yesterday, Bloomberg, Financial Times, and Wall Street Journal, and they all had the European energy crisis on front page. The last one here with the Wall Street Journal and the Norwegian strike is luckily that seems to be over, but power prices and LNG prices in Europe are very elevated. The German 1 year ahead power price was the all-time highest now. The same goes with France and Italy. So you really do have very tight energy market, especially in Europe. When we talk about the overall LNG market, exports in the first half of the year were up about 6%, mostly driven by US. They were putting up 6 million tons extra in the first half of the year. Freeport, which is one of the biggest LNG export plants in the US, closed down early June. So they haven't really put a dent on the growth in US for the first half of the year. They will do more so in the second half of the year. On the import side, it's Europe gobbling up more or less all the LNG cargoes they can. We've seen the lockdowns in China resulted in much lower demand, 23% drop in Chinese imports in the first half of the year. In a normal market, this would be very bad for the freight market. But today you have a buyer of both first and last resort being Europe. So they are taking all these cargoes. But you know, this is one of the reasons why the LNG spot market was so poor in Q1, was the fact that you had a trade centering on Asia, and suddenly all the US spot cargoes, or not all, but at least 70% of the US spot cargoes are going to Europe rather than going the long way to Asia. And that really drove down sailing distances. They fell 15% from Q4 to Q1. But as I will shortly illustrate, you know, the spot market has bounced back despite this pull of cargoes into Europe. So, as I mentioned, the market here are extremely tight. You know, we it feels like all my jeans are slim fit jeans these days after COVID. So this is also how the market is these days. We are talking close to $300 per barrel of oil equivalent for LNG or natural gas in Europe. There is a mismatch here. European gas or TTF, which is the Dutch gas hub, are trading at, when I updated this last, $50. And then actually LNG being sold into Europe is at $42. So it's an $8 spread. This is also a spread we shown in our Q1 update in May. It was also then at $8. This has varied between $3 to $10 difference between kind of gas in the continental pipelines and gas as LNG being shipped into the import terminals. And it's really due to bottlenecks, which I also will cover shortly. Asia, they have a similar spot LNG price, $42. So the arbitrage from US into end consumer are huge. And of course, the traders are making a lot of money shipping spot cargoes to these markets. But what's important to see is that actually 2/3 of all the cargoes are term LNG linked to oil price, where prices are at around $15, and Asia is mostly covered by these contracts. So they are not feeling the pinch in the same way that Europe is, which are relying mostly on buying LNG on the spot. So if we look at these bottles next, these are the import terminal utilization in Europe and Asia. It's a lot of slack in Asia. We talked a couple of years ago about Chinese import terminals getting close to nameplate capacity. Is now 60%, which is quite comfortable in terms of utilization capacity. While in Europe, with this glut of LNG coming into Europe, we are some countries even above the nameplate capacity. Poland, Netherlands above nameplate capacity for imports, and then very elevated levels in both France and Italy, while Spain has a lot of regas capacity but limited connectivity to France. So not surprisingly, people are finding the most flexible way of importing LNG, which is FSRUs, and Germany's been gobbling up four of them, which has also been good for the LNG shipping market, because the FSRU market's been terrible. You know, until this happened, the FSRU market's been terrible for 5 years, and now it's been on fire for the last 3 or 4 months or so, which means that a lot of these LNG carriers, which has been trading as LNG ships, competing with ordinary LNG carriers for business, they are now leaving the market. And rather than adding to the supply of LNG ships, they are actually adding to the demand for LNG ships, because these FSRU terminals, they need cargoes, and they are coming from, of course, the LNG ships. So that's a good balance for the more LNG shipping market. And not surprisingly, most of the countries here in Europe, given the energy crisis, they are expanding capacity. Germany has zero. They're adding these four FSRUs, and they're also planning to build the import terminals at shore. As I mentioned, Spain has a lot of regas capacity. They don't really need to add that, but they have limited connectivity. And you also see other countries like France, Italy, also gobbled up two FSRUs in order to expand capacity rapidly. And same goes with Poland, which also is above nameplate capacity today. There's also bottlenecks also now on the LNG ships in terms of floating storage. When you do have bottlenecks at shore, ships are then waiting and idling in floating storage in order to discharge the cargoes. And at 3 million cubic meters of floating storage, which we were up to recently, that translate into about 20 LNG ships. So this is also something which has been good for the LNG shipping market during the second quarter, and why the market's been better than first quarter, where it was pretty dismal. Another disruption to be aware of: last year we were pretty lucky with the hurricane season. 2020, not so much. Then we had a lot of disruption in US in terms of the hurricane season. And NOAA, which is the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration in US, they recently came out with their prediction: 65% chance for above normal hurricane season, which could result in some disruption. And actually now they have already put the name on all the storms, and the second one is approaching Latin America. It's called Bonnie, and last time I checked, it had 90 knots of speed. So, but it doesn't seem to be affecting the LNG export capacity, but later in the season, that could very much be the case. So utilization level of LNG export plants. If you saw on one of the first market slide here, we saw that Russia is actually, despite all the sanctions, they have been adding 1 million ton of LNG exports in the first half of this year compared to last year. And this is Yamal running at very high levels. So 120% production compared to nameplate. So, but you do have quite a few LNG export plants which are well below nameplate capacity. Of course, Portovia, which is a new Russian LNG plant, has a delayed startup, so it's currently at zero. Snøhvit here in Norway was closed from September 2020 until June. She's back up and running now. It's about 4 million tons, so we do expect that plant to come up to normal utilization levels. But there is quite a few terminals here which could push up production in the shorter term, and given the pricing of the LNG cargoes, you would expect most of the plant owners here to try to optimize production in order to monetize these very high cargo values. Talking about cargo values, as I mentioned also here, Asia has been mostly shielded from the uptick in the spot LNG prices. Of course, when oil price goes up, the oil-linked LNG offtake agreements also goes up. But as you can see here, they are at much lower average import prices than Europe, where the JKM is well above their import prices. And actually, as you can see from China, which is more or less fully covered on term contracts, they have actually, you know, early in the year here, were out trying to sell spot cargoes. Of course, you can't really sell all the term LNG contracts because a lot of them have destination flexibility, but the US volumes you can sell and resell and sell to Europe, and that was the case there early in the year. And then, of course, the European buyers have to pay the spot price. And despite the lack of LNG in Europe and actually where China has been over-contracted on LNG, when it comes to contracting of new LNG, it's been around 100 million tons the last 1.5 years of new contracts. And China represents about half of it. Europe is only 10 million tons. I do think some of this has been in relation to regulatory uncertainty, as Thomas mentioned here with the taxonomy. So with gas now firmly in the green category of the taxonomy, we would expect maybe the European buyers to start contracting more LNG because they certainly need it if they are going to be less reliant from Russian pipeline gas. Of course, the portfolio players, these are like the ones of Shell and Exxon, the big ones, and they are, of course, sometimes contracting LNG for their portfolio and can resell these volumes to the European, which they have done with huge success financially during 2022. So back then to the spot markets, as I mentioned, these are the headline rates. Q1 was quite challenging. A lot of the cargo or the freight was done on one-way economics, which means that the achieved TCE here is well below the headline rates. Then the market bounced back very early, around week 7-8 compared to average of around week 12. And we had a big spike all the way up to early June when Freeport closed. So Freeport is a US LNG export plant with 15 million tons of capacity. And so this is around 15 cargoes a month. And with that closed, there suddenly became a lot of ships available in the market. And we've gone from, let's say, 130,000 to today, maybe 65,000. So a lot softer market at start of Q3. If we put in the FFA, which is the kind of the forward curve for freight, we do expect the market to tighten again when we are getting closer to the winter. So the FFA curve is getting up to around 200,000 late in the season. And that's why we're also saying that our Q4 revenues, there's a bit more variability to this, depending on where you're actually ending up, because the FFA is not always correct. While the spot market's been very volatile, the term market's been very robust. We had a small downtick in the one-year time charter rate in Q1, but it's been ticking up ever since, and also the 3 years. And as I mentioned, in 2020, start of 2021, when you came out of the COVID, you see here the three-year time charter rates down at 50,000, 1 year at 60,000. It wasn't really a good time to fix ships on longer-term charters, and then we have been fixing from, let's say, middle of April 2021 and onwards, when term rates have come up and giving us more profitability doing these contracts. So then, just to conclude, LNG is ESG, especially with this green taxonomy decision today. This is basically about replacing. It used to be about replacing coal with natural gas. Today, it's also about replacing Russian pipeline gas with LNG in Europe. And of course, we have a fleet of the newest ships, 13 Megi XDF ships. On average, these are around 60% more efficient than the older steam generation of ships. So that's at least a good contribution from our side. And today, with the high fuel prices, actually the high fuel prices, I do think will do a lot more for the phasing out of the older ships than EXXI and CII in the short run, because the fuel spreads here between our old steamship and our new ship is just tremendous given the price you can sell the LNG for, because you are burning that LNG as a fuel. So that's it, just on the half hour mark. We can summarize. We fixed all our ships now on longer term time charters, 55 years of backlog with some optional backlog as well here. Revenues this year will be similar to the one we had last year. And then we do expect revenues and TCE to bounce back to even higher levels with 100% coverage next year, where we are avoiding having 4.5 ships in the spot market, which we had in Q1 this year. Next year we will only have one ship on index and the remaining on fixed rate higher. We are initiating more balance sheet optimization and will increase our cash balance even more, which gives us ability to pay out or continue to pay out very attractive quarterly dividends, currently 75 cents per share, which translates to a 12% yield. So that's it.
The company is in a very, very strong and solid position. Investors will be happy with seeing a flow of dividends coming in the next few years. How would you think the company looks like in 2-3 years? You have mentioned that available slots are not until 2027. I think it will be difficult then to do back-to-back charter contracts already today. I don't know of too many acquisition candidates, either by companies or vessels. So will this look much the same in 2-3 years, but with renewed contracts, prolonged coverage, or what do you foresee?
Yeah, no, it's a good question. I think we're not going to just carve kind of the strategy in stone and say that this is, we're going to have 20 ships by 2026 or something. I think we just invest when we find a good opportunity. So I do have some investors now saying that, well, it's very limited growth. Mm-hmm. But we've just been through a tremendous growth phase. Mm. And for us, it's more the question about investing in the ships at the right time and then fixing them at the right time. So, you know, it might very well be that we are 13 ships in 2 years' time if we don't find value in buying ships or contracting ships. It's a story in Tradewinds today about resale of 3 ships and the price is 240 million plus. Mm. So, which means that we find it a bit difficult to defend that investment, especially also when you look at the valuation. The good thing with higher new building prices is, of course, these ships are coming open some in 26. Most of the order book are contracted, so there's not that many speculative orders, of course. At these kind of prices, you have to be very bullish if you are contracting on speculation. So more or less, the vast majority of the new building orders are with the contract linked. Mm. But it also means that those who are speculative, they have a pretty high price. And if you look at these ships, it's the same generation of ships that we ordered. So there's not really a lot of difference in these ships. The kind of the technical revolution has already happened, where you've gone from steam to diesel electric to slow speed two-stroke engine. So I think our ships will be very competitive. I do think that we will have ships coming up, and then, as I mentioned, 25, 26, when we have had these ships and we have paid down quite a lot of debt on these ships. And then they are competing with ships that maybe cost $240 million. But maybe which has a project cost of 260 when you're taking into account the lost kind of yield by investing in these ships, and they are yielding nothing in supervision, etc. So I think that the high new building prices means that term rates have to be at a higher level, because otherwise people will not continue to invest in these ships. So I think that will make all ships attractive recontracting candidates. So we hope to be able to market some of these positions and then maybe adding more backlog to those ships. And then once you're getting to, let's call it 25, 26, we will have a couple of years now with muted growth in liquefaction capacity. So IEA was out with a report today. They are doing a webcast in 26 minutes and they are talking about the muted growth in LNG exports from now to 25. Mm. I think they have 17% growth during that period, so it's 4% growth compared to 8% historically. But from 25, 26, there's a new wave of liquefaction capacity coming on stream. So then the growth in LNG exports will pick up. Ships will be more expensive then. And then you've already had this phase of the new decarbonization rules from IMO, the EEXI, CII. So we would expect by 2025, 26, you're starting to see a lot more scrapping activity of the older ships. So that, I think, we're pretty comfortable having those ships open at that window because of the growth will pick up on the kind of the supply side of LNG. Ships will be gone from the market, and the other ships you are competing with have very high costs in terms of capex.
This is also touching on another question I was thinking to pose, and that's now the market has been driven by the ton miles, excuse me, the volumes to Europe, which is, you know, good with increased volumes, but not so good for ton miles. The second leg of this good or even better market would or could come when you have more supply going to Asia.
Yeah.
So that sounds like it's coming in 2025, 2026, yeah, possibly.
You see China gobbling up half of the contracts. It takes a bit time to build the LNG plant. So of course, China is, you know, actually, which is a big surprise to everybody. China will be a smaller LNG importer than Japan this year, most probably. There's 10 times more people in China than Japan. So it's the growth story of China's LNG import is still early phases. So we do expect, and that's why they also signed up for 50 million tons more. Last year they were importing, it was close to 80, but so you're adding 50 on top of that. So we don't think that the growth story of China has stopped. It's just because of the COVID lockdowns. Keep in mind that the users of LNG in China is mostly the coastal affluent cities, where you have had lockdowns in cities like Shanghai. So once China tackled their COVID situation, we do expect LNG demand to pick up again and grow. But right now it's a bit subdued, but longer term, this is a compelling story longer term, especially now with Europe also replacing a lot of Russian gas, which they have to then replace with LNG and probably, of course, renewables as well.
Has this tight energy market made you see any notable numbers of new feeds for gas fields
already? Yeah, we've seen some, you know, some Eni and New Fortress have done some rapid expansion projects, but you know, all the big projects in US are looking at expansion. So of course, Cheniere is working on this, Sempra, Freeport, once they get the Freeport terminal started up again, they are looking to expand, and then also you have this Telluria next decade. So we do expect a lot of US expansion on the LNG side. It's also related to the fact that you have so much access to cheap gas. Henry Hub now is below $6. So, and of course, there are a lot of shale gas which can be drilled very profitable today, both in terms of the oil price and the gas price, and that gives you access to a lot of LNG quickly. Building LNG plants in US is also much quicker than most places. Calcasieu Pass, which was built within 29 months from FID to first cargo, that's a lot quicker than building an LNG ship these days, which is taking close to 4 years.
Now have some reaction from our participants, and we have a few questions here that I would like to pose them. One straight question is it time now to acquire Golar at the discount price?
I think Golar sold off all the ships in Coolco, so we're not really going into the FLNG business.
And how is the development of fuel efficiency on the vessels?
Yeah, I show a graph here on it. The new ships are, of course, a lot more efficient than the older ships. The steamships were very inefficient, and that's why you don't have steam engines on other ships type. But it was because of the boil-off. It's a very easy way to deal with the boil-off. So, as I mentioned, around 58% reduction. What you are seeing now in terms of further improvements are more related to methane slip. So that's been put high on the agenda, and we had this on the COP26, that people really, because it's a very quick way of reducing global warming because of the potency of methane. Of course, we have 9 of our ships with Megi engines. They are reducing the methane slip to virtually zero. It's 11 times less than a dry fuel ships. So you have focus on the methane. That's why we're also seeing some of these XDFs 2.0, where you're reducing the methane slip. That's one thing. Then it's more gradual improvements. You could have air lubrication, so you're creating bubbles under the hull, so you're reducing the drag when you are going through the water. Shaft generators in order to use the auxiliary engine less, but it's tiny improvements. It's not like in the past when you've gone from a steam engine burning 185 tons to a Megi engine burning 100 tons. These improvements are more like improving 2-4% rather than 50%.
Not to ruin the magic moment then, Øystein, but just to address the elephant in the room, I only know one market with a higher order book than the LNG market. It's close to 40%.
Yeah.
Can you see how this is going to be by new regulations and possibly new projects, that this is going to actually balance out the supply demand anyways?
Yeah, no, it's a good question. I get surprised all the time how eager people are to order a ship. But as I mentioned, most of the ships here are linked to a contract. It's not speculative orders. So there's a couple of reasons for this. It's the fact that you have 200 steamships, which will basically be dead in the water once these decarbonization rules start to bite. So it's the IMO rules. And then it's the fuel prices. LNG prices are high today, but the future prices are also pretty high. So having these ships is extremely expensive in terms of fuel costs. And then you have EU also implementing the ETS scheme for the maritime sector. So that will also further penalize the inefficient ships. And that will also penalize probably the ships with a high methane slip. So there you have some drivers for scrapping. Also the fact that steel prices are pretty firm, so you get a very decent sum of money for scrapping a ship. So there are some big drivers for scrapping. And then you also have on the demand side, you have not that many new projects starting up the next 3 years, but from 25, 26, it's a wave of new LNG hitting the market, and those projects, they need ships. A lot of the volumes are, of course, centered on Qataris. They are expanding 49 million tons, basically the portfolio of new Chinese contracts. So they need, you know, they have reserved 151 berths, just Qataris. So that will, altogether, I expect that to be well above 100 orders, because they are expanding for Qatar, but they're also expanding on the Golden Pass in US, which probably need 25, 30 ships. So it's a lot of new supply coming, and then you have some ships going out. So, but you know, if you're in shipping and you're not worried about the order book, you're not paying attention.
So thank you for that final question. In these turbulent, unstable times, I wish, as it says on your last page of presentation, all investors and the company, bon voyage. And it must be comfortable to look forward to so healthy returns in the next few years. Not next few, but for quite a few years onwards. So thank you very much, Mr. Kolleklev. Thank you for coming.
Okay, thank you, Thomas, and thank you everybody for listening in.
We'll be right back.